In New York for the first criminal trial of a former U.S. president. At least 50 potential jurors dismissed after saying they cannot be fair and impartial in deciding whether Donald Trump is guilty or innocent in his hush money case. Other potential jurors will be vetted Tuesday. A panel of 12 New Yorkers and 6 alternatives will be selected, but the process could take 2 weeks or more, with Trump's trial possibly spilling into June. Trump was charged with falsifying records to cover up a $130,000 payment to adult film actress Stormy Daniels during his 2016 campaign to buy her silence about a 2006 sexual encounter. Trump has denied any relationship with Daniels and has pleaded not guilty.
It looks like the judge isn't going to allow me to escape this scam. It's a scam trial. If you read all of the legal pundits, all of the legal scholars today, there's not one that I see that said this is a case that should be brought or tried. It's a scam. It's a political witch hunt. It continues, and it continues forever. And we're not going to be given a fair trial. It's a very, very sad thing.
Falsifying business records in New York is a felony punishable by up to 4 years in prison. But the guilty verdict would not bar Trump from running for the presidency. Here's how New Yorkers are reacting to Trump's historic trial. Some residents in the heavily Democratic state believe Trump should not even be allowed to run for the White House, given all his cases. Trump is so far facing 88 criminal charges in 4 cases, but he denies any wrongdoing.
As someone that is running for president, the fact that he's on trial, that shouldn't be allowed. So I disagree completely with him being able to run as president while being investigated for several civil cases and criminal cases.
Truth is, any upstanding citizen, whether it's a minor infraction or whatever, you pay your time, you know what I mean? And it doesn't matter who you are. Like, I could be the best person in the world, but if I make a mistake, I have to own up to it.
Meanwhile, Trump supporters also showed up in force outside the courthouse in New York.
Well, it's not going to be fair. And like I said, if the man steps on a roach, they're going to try to convict him for murder. And this is not the America I grew up in. It's frightening and it's horrible. And people are not speaking out. And I'll be so upset if when this country is turned and people say, what's going on? It's not fair. Shut up, because you didn't do anything to stop it.
Turning now to the escalating tensions in the Middle East. The Israeli army vowing retaliation against Iran following its unprecedented attack over the weekend. The strike involved over 300 missiles and drones and was launched in response to a suspected Israeli airstrike on its embassy compound in Damascus on April 1st. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu summoned his war cabinet for the second time in less than 24 hours to decide how to react to Iran's first ever direct attack on Israel.
I want to thank all our international partners who stood up to Iran's aggression. Iran's attack has created new opportunities for cooperation in the Middle East. We are closely assessing the situation. We remain at our highest level of readiness. Iran will face the consequences for its actions. We will choose our response accordingly.
The statement from Israel's army chief comes amid calls for restraint by allies anxious to avoid an escalation of the conflict in the Middle East. Iraqi Prime Minister Mohammed Shia al-Sudani calls for restraint in the Middle East as tensions soar between Iran and Israel. Sudani is leading a delegation that is meeting officials across Washington, including U.S. President Joe Biden and Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin. Iraq is a rare ally of both Washington and Tehran. Iraqi airspace was a main route for Iran's unprecedented attack on Israel, and Iraqi officials say Iran informed them, as well as other countries in the region, ahead of the offensive.
إيقاف هذه الحرب المدمرة.
We actually very eager about stopping this war, which claimed the life of thousands of civilians, women and children. And we encourage all the efforts about stopping the expansion of the area of conflict, especially the latest development, and we encourage all for these trains and to protect the safety and security of the region.
The United States is committed to Israel's security. We're committed to a ceasefire that will bring the hostages home and preventing conflict from spreading beyond what it already has. We're also committed to the security of our personnel and partners in the region, including Iraq.
Despite escalating fears of a wider regional conflict, no Filipino in Israel has yet expressed a desire to come home. Still, the Philippine Foreign Affairs Department says it stands ready to repatriate Filipinos should there be a need to do so. Israel's ambassador to Manila, meanwhile, gives his assurance defense mechanisms in place will protect Filipinos in Israel and that the Israeli economy is open and functioning.
Tingin namin hindi sila uuwi, pero handang pamahalaan na kung sinong gustong uwi, tutulungan namin ma-repatriate. Wala pa Pilipinong sasabing kami. Paghahandaan ng embassy yung mass repatriation.
And as I said before, you can see that the Israeli economy, Israeli society, everything is fully functioning. And I'll be happy to present this to any relevant and interested authorities of the Philippines and Filipino decision makers and politicians. But at the end of the day, I fully respect a decision of a sovereign country on how to approach to their own citizens.
There are around 30,000 Filipinos living and working in Israel. Efforts to end wars in the Middle East and Ukraine expected to dominate this week's meeting of the group of seven foreign ministers in Italy. The ministers from the U.S., Italy, Germany, Japan, France, Britain, and Canada will present a united front in demanding a ceasefire in Gaza and reiterate the full backing for Ukraine in its two-year war against Russia. Israel has resisted repeated calls to halt their Gaza offensive, while in Ukraine, the momentum has shifted in Russia's favor, with the West seemingly incapable of providing Kyiv with a weaponry it desperately needs.
Our international position is very clear. But if our position is strong, it's easier to talk with the others. We are united. This is crucial.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. claims he's on good terms with Vice President Sara Duterte, but he admits it's a different story with the Vice President's father. Pia Gutierrez reports.
It's complicated. That's how President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. describes his relationship right now with the Duterte clan, as the Philippine leader and his predecessor, former President Rodrigo Duterte, continue to clash on various national issues, from charter change to the West Philippine Sea.
It's complicated. It's complicated, but if you ask about the one, of course, that I have the most contact with is Inday Sara, and how we were with each other during the campaign, after the election, it hasn't really changed.
But despite a recent falling out with the Dutertes, the president during a forum of the Foreign Correspondents Association of the Philippines says his administration remains firm that it will not hand over Duterte to the International Criminal Court. This as he insists that the ICC does not have jurisdiction over the Philippines.
We don't recognize the warrant that they will send to us.
So that's a no?
That's a no. It is the rule of ICC that they come in when there is no judiciary. They come in when there is no police force. We have a judiciary. The Chief Justice, the former Chief Justice, is sitting right here. He will explain to you how healthy and robust and active the judiciary is. The police force, I think, the same thing.
Meanwhile, during the forum, the president announced that the Philippines will no longer give the United States access to more military bases in the country under the Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement, or EDCA.
The Philippines has no plans to open or to establish more EDCA bases.
The Philippines has designated a total of 9 EDCA sites in various strategic military bases in the country, which allows the U.S. to position its facilities and equipment there.
These are reactions to what has happened in the South China Sea, to the aggressive actions that we have had to deal with, the water cannoning, the lasers, the collision, the blocking of our bangka, our fishermen, the putting of barriers across Scarborough Shoal. This is a reaction to that. This did not cause that. That happened before we had EDCA.
When asked about his family's ill-gotten wealth, the president says that he's leaving it to his lawyers to handle these cases, including the contested $40 million Arelma asset of the Marcoses.
It's hard for me to answer. I really haven't looked at it in years. And I would advise you to talk to the lawyers that are handling it, because I'm not being specious or anything like that. Matagal ko nang hindi narinig yung pangalan na Arelma. The previous cases, the cases that were filed post-1986, I have not touched. I have nothing. It would be highly improper for me to involve myself in that. Besides, I don't have the time to do it, so I leave it to the lawyers.
As to whether the president will apologize to victims of atrocities committed under his father's martial rule, Marcos Jr. says it is not his duty as Philippine leader to be involved, adding that it is a personal matter for the Marcos family.
But you are a member of the Marcos family.
Definitely, but it's more, my role as president is more important right now than my role as a member of the Marcos family. So I take that, that's my first priority.
According to the data of Amnesty International, over 100,000 Filipinos were killed, imprisoned, or tortured under the martial law regime of the president's late father, President Ferdinand Marcos Sr. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
President Marcos believes China is not making up the supposed gentleman's agreement involving his predecessor, former President Rodrigo Duterte. China has insisted Manila reneged on it, some of its promises, including towing away the rusting BRP Sierra Madre, as well as maintaining the status quo in Ayungin Shoal. Marcos says Duterte should have informed him of the secret deal. He adds the lack of evidence stops Duterte from being held liable for his actions.
Why did you keep it secret? Why is there not one single document that contains that agreement? Why is there not one shred of evidence that can show that this agreement exists? Why, when we the transition period between the previous administration to this administration, did no one mention a secret agreement? These are very simple questions. But I'm finding a great deal of difficulty finding answers for them, because I hear one thing and another thing and another thing and another thing. It's all very maraming palusot. In other words, I don't know how to translate that in English, but maraming palusot.
Philippine state forces reaffirmed their loyalty to the 1987 Constitution following a call to turn their back on the Marcos administration. Davao del Norte Representative Pantaleon Alvarez earlier appealed to the military and the police to withdraw their support for President Marcos. This as he expressed concerns about the rising tensions in the West Philippine Sea.
Pag po nag-withdraw kayo ng suporta sa kanya, ibig sabihin, sinusuportahan nyo ang provision sa saligang batas na to protect the people and the state. Pag po nag-withdraw kayo ng suporta sa kanya, wala na siyang ibang magagawa kundi bababa sa pwesto niya. Pag sumabog ang gulo sa West Philippine Sea, there will be countless of dead bodies. There will be unimaginable destruction, famine, hunger.
The armed forces gave assurance it will uphold its mandate of protecting the Filipino people, regardless of who's in power. The PNP, meanwhile, said it will look into whether Alvarez's statement could be considered seditious.
The AFP reiterates our unwavering commitment to professionalism, loyalty, and of course to the Constitution, and our strict adherence to the chain of command. Our soldiers, our pilots, and our sailors and Marines remain dedicated to our mandate of safeguarding the sovereignty and territorial integrity of the Philippines, regardless of any political affiliations and or individuals in authority. Our duty is to protect the Filipino people and to uphold the rule of law, ensuring that peace and development will prevail throughout the nation. We will continue to fulfill these responsibilities with integrity, impartiality, and utmost dedication.
Well, pag-aaralan po natin yan ng ating mga legal officers po and other concerned units po if those statement may be considered as a seditious statement. But for now po, ay hindi po tayo muna hantong sa mga ganyang usapin po dahil sabi po nga ay we will see. We will monitor po kung ano pong magiging sitwasyon po in terms of peace and security.
Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. The final buzzer sounded for the NBA regular season as the fourth seed LA Clippers rested their stars. They got a visit from the Houston Rockets and their Phil-Am star, Jalen Green. The game between the Clippers and the Rockets, which carried no impact on the playoff picture, ended in a 116-105 win for Houston. Green scored 13 points while grabbing 6 rebounds. The Filipino-American has finished his third NBA season, playing all 82 games, averaging just under 20 points per game as he continued to flash his potential.
I stuck it out and found, you know, who I am in the whole, like, rebuild of the season. You know, I had to break some habits. I'm still breaking habits to the last game, but I think I figured it out. And, yeah, I think I have a good carry-on for next season.
The win caps off a 41-41 season for the Rockets, their best finish since Green was selected as a number 2 overall draft pick in 2021. The Rockets won 20 games during Green's rookie season, followed by 22 wins in his second season. Under the new coach, Ime Udoka, and several key free agent pickups, the Rockets went on an 11-game winning streak in March, keeping them alive in the playoff picture late into the season. And finally, the only Filipino head coach in the NBA, Eric Spoelstra, and the Miami Heat now know their path to the NBA Finals. Defending Eastern Conference champions Miami Heat, led by head coach Eric Spoelstra, finished 8th in the Eastern Conference, just as it did last year. The Heat will have to survive the play-in tournament. They'll face the Philadelphia 76ers on Wednesday.
Yeah, looking forward to it. It'll be a great environment. Philly's been playing fantastic, recently. So we know what to expect up there, and that is what we say, you know, it's for competitors only, and it should be a lot of fun.
The NBA postseason begins with the play-in tournament on Tuesday as the Oklahoma City Thunder's the top seed in the West with the defending champion Denver Nuggets in the number 2 seed. And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. Head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at The Rundown.
Now let's get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Chanel Dominguez. Hi, Chanel.
Good morning, Bettina, and good morning to all. So we currently have a trough of low pressure area which is affecting Davao region, South Cotabato, and Sarangani. Expect a cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorm. This low pressure area is unlikely to enter the Philippine area of responsibility and also unlikely to develop into a tropical cyclone. On the other hand, expect here in Metro Manila and the rest of our country a generally fair weather, however, a warm and humid afternoon and a chances of localized thunderstorm during the afternoon and the evening. Expect a temperature between 25 to 35 degrees here in Metro Manila and a heat index of 42 degrees Celsius. That's the latest here in Pag-asa Weather Forecasting Center. Chanel Dominguez, and good morning.
Thank you very much for that update, Chanel.